Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Poppy Harmon Investigates by Lee Hollis, narrated by Kim Niemi. Chapter 1. Poppy frantically banged on the door of the house, but there was no answer. She waited a few moments and then tried again. Still no answer. A foreboding sense of dread filled her entire body. She had learned at a very young age to trust her intuition, and she instinctively knew something was seriously wrong. Poppy jiggled the door handle. The door was unlocked. She waited, debating with herself, and then sighed, making a quick decision. She pushed the door open slightly and poked her head inside. Hello? Anyone home? The single-level house was eerily quiet, except for some soft music playing from somewhere not too far away. She couldn't tell who was singing because the volume was too low. Poppy pushed the door all the way open and slipped inside, looking back to make sure none of the nosy neighbors on the idyllic, sleepy street saw her sneaking into a house where she did not live. Hello? She tried one more time, but there was still no answer. She was hardly surprised. Poppy had guest starred in enough TV crime shows in the 1980s to know this was usually the point in the show when an unsuspecting woman found herself in the wrong place at the wrong time and suddenly fell prey to a mad killer or a treacherous villain seconds before the commercial break. Still, her burning curiosity won out over her innate cautiousness, and she shut the door behind her and slowly, carefully tiptoed farther into the foyer, looking around to be absolutely certain no one was lying in wait to suddenly jump out at her with a rag soaked with chloroform or, worse, a sharp weapon like a carving knife or a rope cord from the curtains, which he could use to loop around her neck and strangle her to death. Again, she had played a lot of damsels in distress during her years of acting in film and on television, so her imagination tended to run a bit wild. There was hardly that kind of violent crime to be found in California's Coachella Valley, her home for the past 10 years, and yet there were alarm bells suddenly going off in her head. She had never felt such a strong sense of imminent danger. Poppy followed the sound of the music toward the living room, where she was finally able to recognize the familiar voice belting out a classic song on an old CD player set up in a corner on a small wooden desk adjacent to the fireplace. It was Elaine Stritch, the brassy, ballsy, late Broadway legend, and the song was The Ladies Who Lunch from the hit 1970s Stephen Sondheim musical Company. How appropriate, Poppy thought, given the majority of women who resided here in the Palm Leaf Retirement Village, most of whom spent their days golfing during the morning and enjoying cocktails in the afternoon during their typical, like clockwork, daily 3-hour lunches. She had moved farther into the living room in order to turn off the CD player when she caught something out of the corner of her eye. Poppy spun around, gasping, her right hand flying to her mouth. She struggled to steady herself as she stared at the body lying face down on the floor next to a cracked coffee table. A small pool of blood seeped slowly into the pristine white carpet. Chapter 2. 2 months earlier. Poppy Harmon was speechless, perhaps for the very first time in her life, and she was 62 years old. Poppy had always been known for her enviable ability to bravely respond to a crisis with a calm, focused demeanor. She was never rattled or flummoxed or prone to overreaction, which was what made today such a momentous occasion. Poppy Harmon was at this moment completely freaking out. With her mouth hanging open, she finally managed to reclaim her power of speech and leaned forward. "What the hell are you talking about?" Poppy wailed, suddenly lightheaded, desperately trying to steady herself before she fainted and tumbled off the flimsy chair that faced her lawyer, Edwin Pierce, in his spacious, well-appointed office in Palm Desert, California. Edwin's face was drawn, his complexion as pale as pasteurized milk, and his eyes were bloodshot, with the lids hanging at half-mast. The poor man was obviously sleep-deprived, having probably been up all night, dreading this unavoidable and supremely uncomfortable meeting with his client. As I said, Chester unfortunately had accumulated some debt before he passed away, and according to my calculations, the sum total he owed... Edwin's voice trailed off as he punched a few numbers into a calculator program on his computer screen. Poppy noticed his hand shaking as he brushed the keys with his crooked, bony fingers. He was a bundle of nerves. "How much, Edwin?" Poppy urged, wanting to get the bad news over with so she could begin dealing with the situation. Edwin blinked at the screen, almost in disbelief at the final total, and then he cleared his throat before continuing.
"Roughly $670,000.
Poppy stared blankly at Edwin. She must have heard wrong. Maybe he said $6,000, which would be bad enough, but surely he could not have possibly said...
$670,000,
Edwin repeated. That's impossible. How on earth did he... I would have known if he was spending that much.
It seems Chester had a small gambling problem.
He played poker with the boys twice a month. I would hardly call that a gambling problem, Poppy scoffed, still in a state of denial.
He played more than poker, I'm afraid. There were dozens of weekend trips to Las Vegas, according to my records.
Those were business trips, Poppy quickly explained, as if saying the words would make them true. Edwin gave Poppy a sad look of pity. The wife was always the last to know.
Chester was fired from his job a year ago.
What? Poppy screamed.
I'm guessing from your reaction that he never told you.
Poppy shook her head, now on the verge of tears. I don't understand. Why wouldn't he tell me something like that?
He was probably too embarrassed. You know Chester, he was a very proud man.
Poppy stared at Edwin. Actually, I'm beginning to suspect that I never actually knew Chester.
I'm sure the stress of hiding all of this from you contributed to his heart attack.
Chester had died suddenly 3 weeks ago. He and Poppy had been dining with friends at Wang's in the desert, a popular Asian fusion restaurant in Palm Springs. As dessert was served, Chester complained of indigestion and excused himself to go to the restroom. When he hadn't returned 20 minutes later, Poppy sent his buddy Al, who was at the table, to go check on him. Al found him slumped over on the toilet in a stall, dead. The days following Chester's sudden death were a blur. Calling friends and relatives, making funeral arrangements, providing emotional support for her daughter, Heather, who was inconsolable over losing her favorite stepfather. There had been two others after her biological father, but Chester was her absolute favorite. The last thing on Poppy's mind during all the grief and tears was their finances. Chester had never given any hint they were in any kind of trouble. In fact, they had just splurged on a cruise to the Greek islands, bought a new Chrysler Pacifica hybrid, remodeled a guest suite in their 5-bedroom, 3.5-bath home nestled in the hills above Palm Springs. The house. Poppy absolutely loved their house. I'm not going to have to sell the house to pay off this debt, am I? Edwin swallowed hard. She could see his Adam's apple move up and down. That was not a good sign.
Not if you can make the payments on the mortgages.
Mortgages? But the house is paid off.
Chester took out 2 mortgages against the value of the property, each in the amount of $200,000.
The blood drained from Poppy's face.
There isn't much equity left, and with what you owe on the credit cards and personal loans...
I'm going to have to sell.
I think that would be a wise move, Edwin said quietly, eyes downcast.
What about his pension?
Gone.
Our savings? Edwin hesitated, but then opened his mouth to answer, but she beat him to it. Gone. Edwin nodded.
There is some good news, Poppy. You still have your SAG pension. During the 80s and 90s, Poppy had dabbled in acting, scoring small parts in a string of TV shows and feature films, even nabbing a supporting role as a secretary on a Private Eye series that lasted 3 seasons on ABC. She had made enough income before she left the business in order to get married and have a kid and enjoy a small pension when she turned 60. Small being the key word. Her monthly check was $548. Before taxes. What was she going to do now? The thought of Chester's betrayal was overwhelming, and she wanted to kick herself for being too stupid not to suspect. She knew what she was in for now. Pitied to her face, laughed at behind her back, poor ding-a-ling aging starlet Poppy. She hadn't had a clue about her gambling-addicted washout of a husband, and her fourth one at that. After 4 times, you would think she would get it right. Edwin stood up from his desk, walked around, and placed a comforting hand on Poppy's padded shoulder. "You will get through this, Poppy. I've known you a long time." "You're a strong woman," Edwin lied. "Are there any more secrets you need to tell me? We might as well get it all out in the open now." Edwin flinched and opened his mouth to tell her something, but for some reason he changed his mind at the last second and shook his head. "No, nothing." She knew he was lying. If she pushed hard enough, she was convinced she could get him to spill the beans about what he was still holding back. But she was too emotionally battered at the moment to even try. At this point, there was a part of her that just didn't want to know. Poppy stared straight ahead, her mind racing, bile rising in her throat.
"Penny for your thoughts?"
Edwin asked softly. "A lousy penny isn't going to help me much right now, Edwin."
"It's best to let it all out. Tell me what's going through your mind."
"If I had known the bastard had wiped me out, I never would have chosen such an expensive casket." Chapter 3. The only reason I married Chester was so I could have a stable, stress-free life in the desert and not have to worry about my financial security anymore, Poppy moaned as she sipped her Cosmo at the 19th hole, a popular bar located in the clubhouse of the Whispering Palms golf course. She sat at a table with her two best friends, Iris Becker, a very sturdy and direct German woman, her white hair beautifully coiffured and her makeup picture perfect in a bright yellow-colored polo shirt and white capri pants, and Violet Hogan, Iris's polar opposite, quiet and demure, bordering on mousy, but constantly trying to change that impression with her bold fashion choices, like today's leopard print sleeveless top and clashing black and white polka dot shorts.
"Well, yes, that, and you loved him," Violet said, gently nudging Poppy between sips of her Grey Goose and lemonade.
"Of course I loved him, but after 3 failed marriages, I wasn't in a big hurry to rush right into another one. Chester was the one who convinced me that by marrying him, I would never have to worry about anything ever again. I could focus on my charities and political causes."
"That was obviously to keep you in the dark about what he was really doing. Never trust a man who offers to take care of you, because the opposite will happen and you will be stuck taking care of him,"
Iris said matter-of-factly, never one to mince words, in her heavy German accent. She continued,
"In my 20s, there was a filmmaker I met through Fassbinder, who I went bar-hopping with in Munich. Well, he fell for me instantly and begged me to be in his next film, but I said no. What do I know about acting? All my friends thought I was insane to turn down such a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, but I did not want to be tied down in one place making a movie. Besides, I found something better to do. So he found another muse, made his film with her as the star. They impulsively married the night of the film's opening. But then the movie flopped. He never directed another film again, and she wound up supporting him by doing softcore porn disguised as French art films."
"I don't think I could have turned down a starring role in a film," Poppy said. "What could have been better to do than that?"
"I hooked up with Mick Jagger at a beer garden in Berlin and spent the summer talking with the Stones."
Poppy sat back in her chair, impressed. "You're right, that is better."
"You've lived such an interesting life, Iris," Violet said wistfully. "So full of fascinating stories.
I suppose so, compared to you, Iris said, nodding.
Violet was a retired high school principal from Massachusetts. Not the most exciting past, but she did have a library named after her, and she continued to this day to receive letters from dozens of former students heaping praise on her and gushing about how much of an influence she had been on them, which, in Poppy's mind, was just as impressive as Iris's wild jet-setting tales of yesteryear.
I do not understand how he took out 2 mortgages against the house without you knowing about it, Iris said. I assume the house was under both your names?
Yes, Poppy nodded, supremely embarrassed. Edwin showed me the loan applications. My messy signature was on both of them. Either Chester had me sign them without me knowing what they were, or he forged my name. It doesn't really matter. Either way, I'm responsible.
And you had no idea what he was up to? Violet asked, placing a comforting hand on Poppy's arm.
That's the most humiliating part. No, I had no clue what was going on. Chester isn't what you would call a masterful con man. It was pretty much what you see is what you get. I always knew what he was thinking. There weren't a lot of layers, if you know what I mean. Which means I just wasn't paying attention. I was caught up in my own activities, blissfully ignorant of the fact that my husband was leading a secret life behind my back.
What are you going to do now? Violet asked.
Well, I'm meeting with a realtor tomorrow to put the house on the market. It's going to be a short sale because I can no longer make the payments, which means it will probably sell quickly, and then I have to find another place to live.
You will stay with me until you find a place, Iris said, deciding the matter without even waiting for Poppy to accept her kind offer.
You can stay with me, too, Violet offered, feeling left out.
Don't be silly, Violet, Iris said. My house has more room, and the patio has a far superior view.
Iris was never mean-spirited, just brutally honest.
Thank you, both of you, Poppy said. I couldn't ask for better friends.
I know, Iris said, nodding.
And then I suppose I'm going to have to find a job.
Poppy caught Iris and Violet exchanging concerned looks.
What was that? Poppy asked.
What? Iris and Violet said in unison.
That worried look between you two.
It was nothing, Violet lied in a valiant effort to protect Poppy's feelings. Iris, however, was not one to protect feelings. The hard, bitter truth was always best, and she had no problem dishing it out.
What skills do you have? You haven't worked in over 20 years, Iris said gruffly.
Iris was right. Poppy's last serious job was as a Hollywood actress. But once ABC canceled her only steady gig after 3 seasons, she struggled to find acting roles. All the sexpot roles that seemed to have rained down upon her in her 20s had long dried up, and she never managed to get cast in a part that required any serious acting chops. When she was just shy of 40 and her youthful looks began to fade, despite some nips and tucks and scary injections, no one was willing to give her a chance anymore. When she left Hollywood on her 40th birthday, she never looked back. And never worried about working ever again, especially since her 3rd husband at the time, Ira Greenstein, was a successful entertainment attorney.
Maybe I could get back into acting.
I always said when I was more mature, there would be so many roles I could finally play.
I just heard they are holding auditions for Steel Magnolias at the Palm Springs Playhouse, Violet said excitedly.
How much are they paying?
They didn't say anything about money.
Which means there is none, Iris said, waving off Violet's useless suggestion. She's not going to pay her rent by playing a part that Shirley MacLaine performed better in the movie.
Maybe I could go back to Hollywood, Poppy said, trying to convince herself this was a plausible course of action.
Forget it, Iris said. All those mature roles you are finally ready to play are going to go to Meryl Streep. Believe me.
I think we should try to stay positive, Iris, Violet scolded.
I know. I am positive Poppy going back to acting is not the answer, Iris said. We need a good idea.
That one stung Poppy, but she certainly couldn't argue with it.
What am I going to do? I've never balanced a checkbook, let alone stuck to a budget in my life, Poppy moaned.
We are here to help you, Violet said, and so is Heather.
Poppy gasped. Her daughter, Heather.
She was still in the dark about the whole situation. "Tell me you told Heza what is going on," Iris said.
"No. I drove right over here from the lawyer's office. I didn't want to call her in the car and fall apart on the phone. Not until I can come up with a plan."
"You have to tell her. If you don't, she is going to find out from someone else, and that will not be good," Iris warned.
"But she is so high-strung and emotional, and she was so close to Chester and always held him in such high regard. How can I tell her he squandered away all our savings, including her rather sizable inheritance, before he kicked the bucket?"
A waiter appeared at the table with a piece of paper. His face was tight and his movements were stiff. It was obvious he was pained to have to do this. But he took a deep breath and powered through, handing Poppy the paper.
"Your bill, ma'am?"
Poppy stared at the paper for a long moment and then calmly looked up at the nervous young waiter.
"It says I owe $4,539. Now, I know you raised your prices, but three cocktails and a plate of stuffed mushrooms shouldn't cost this much."
"I know, ma'am," the waiter said, clearing his throat.
"But your late husband, and I am so sorry for your loss, he paid for a lot of meals he had with his golf buddies over the past year or so and ran a tab, which he unfortunately never had the chance to pay. And now the owner is insisting you pay it off or forfeit club membership."
"I can't pay it," Poppy said, slumping in her chair. Then she quietly picked her purse up off the floor next to her chair, stood up, and forced a smile.
"I always thought golf was boring anyhow. There, now I can say it."
"Where are you going?" Violet asked.
"To tell Heather," Poppy said, glancing around the room, noticing several tables of club members either staring directly at her or averting their gaze to avoid eye contact.
"Iris is right. If I don't get to her first, there are about a dozen little birdies right here in this clubhouse who will happily do it for me."
Chapter 4. Poppy went over in her mind the conversation she was about to have as she sat at a corner table at Las Casuelas, a popular Mexican eatery in the heart of Palm Springs. She had promised herself not to indulge in the basket of salty, greasy taco chips that would greet her at the table when she arrived and was seated, but the stress of breaking her troubling news to her daughter that she was broke quickly dissolved any remaining vestiges of self-control. There was only a handful of crumbled chips left in the basket after only 5 minutes at the table, and the waiter had to scurry off for another serving of salsa so she could finish them off after he delivered her Cadillac margarita on the rocks, the first of several she would be downing during the course of the meal, for sure. She had practiced silently to herself just how she was going to tell Heather, and she had imagined her daughter's response, starting with the inevitable shock which would soon give way to a self-pitying, "Why is this happening to me?" crying jag, and would finally wrap up with unadulterated sheer panic once it sank in that her inheritance was entirely gone. Poppy would try her best to remain a calming influence, but the fact that at the moment she was screaming and hysterical on the inside didn't bode well for her playing the role of supportive and reassuring mother. A three-man mariachi band snapped her out of her thoughts as they weaved through the table singing El Rey. The lead singer was lean and handsome, with a pencil-thin mustache, and was enjoying the attention from the room as he crooned, aiming his velvety chords toward the female patrons, including Poppy. He broke into a wide smile as he passed by, serenading her, and for a brief moment Poppy thought he might have recognized her from her TV work, but then the reality of his age, late 20s at most, settled in, and she figured he was just doing his job charming all the eye-batting enamored older ladies in the house. She was halfway through her first margarita and keeping an eye out for the waiter to be prepared to fetch another when she spotted Heather by the hostess stand. Poppy had to wave a few times before Heather noticed her, but when she did, her daughter beamed, bright and happy, not a care in the world. Poppy dreaded the idea of the cold, hard slap in the face she was about to deliver. Heather bounded over to the table and plopped down in a chair after a quick air kiss with her mother. She was wearing a flattering pink print sundress. Her hair had recently been curled and styled, and there was a generous amount of makeup covering every blemish. Poppy had never seen Heather go to such efforts to look pretty for a night out with Mom, but she didn't question it. In hindsight, she probably should have.
"Sorry I'm late. There was a lot of traffic on the 111, Heather said, scooping up a chip and dipping it in the fresh bowl of salsa the waiter had just dropped off.
"Was there an accident?" Poppy asked.
"No, just your typical Palm Springs traffic jam, which we both know is a bunch of old people driving too slow."
Poppy smiled. "You look lovely tonight, dear."
"Thank you," Heather said. "I wanted to look nice for this special occasion."
Poppy suddenly panicked. Did she forget Heather's birthday? No. Heather was born on December 22nd. That was still months away. "Special occasion?" Poppy asked, giving up trying to figure it out.
"Yes," Heather said slyly, glancing around the restaurant as if looking for someone. "I've invited someone to join us for dinner."
Oh, no. The last thing Poppy wanted was a third party at the table. She had steeled herself to do this, and she could not put it off any longer.
"Heather, I thought it was just going to be the two of us. I have something I need to talk about, and it's very important. There he is!"
Heather giggled, waving her arms frantically at a young man who had just breezed into the restaurant and was glad-handing the hostess and apparently talking her ear off. He was average height, but movie star handsome, with dark, close-cropped hair, a goatee that was bordering on ironic, and an air of self-assurance which the hostess, at least, found intoxicating. She pointed at their table, and with a big grin plastered on his face, the young man practically jogged over, arms outstretched, as Heather jumped to her feet and fell into his embrace. They hugged for what seemed like a whole minute before pulling just far enough away from each other to gaze into the other's eyes, then concluded their touching reunion with a long, sloppy, wet kiss.
Oh, God, Poppy thought. Heather has a new boyfriend.
The handsome young man quickly turned his attention to Poppy and with a hand over his heart said dramatically, "You must be Poppy. I've heard so much about you. All bad."
"Excuse me?" Poppy asked.
He broke out into a fit of giggles. "Kidding, kidding."
"You'll get used to his weird sense of humor," Heather felt the need to mention as she slapped him playfully on the arm and told him to sit down.
He reached over, grabbed Poppy's hand, and after a short struggle, with Poppy fruitlessly trying to withdraw it, he managed to pucker up his lips and smack the back of her hand with a loud kiss. When he finally let go, Poppy yanked her hand back, grabbed the stem of her margarita glass, and took a generous gulp.
"Mom, this is Matt Cameron. We met at yoga class," Heather said.
I was in a downward dog position, spotted her through my legs, stretching that glorious body of hers, and presto, I was immediately hooked, he said, winking at Heather.
"Matt's an actor," Heather said proudly.
The information was coming fast and furious. Poppy didn't know where to start. Having been married to two actors in her lifetime, not to mention the dozens that she had dated back in the day, Poppy was reasonably sure the last kind of man she would ever want her daughter mixed up with would be an actor. Poppy's hopes of having that serious discussion with her daughter about their uncertain future was going to have to be postponed. Especially since from the moment the topic of his chosen profession was introduced, Matt Cameron never stopped talking about himself. How he wowed his hometown in upstate New York with his indelible performance in Evita, playing the rabble-rouser anarchist Che to packed houses at his local community theater before taking the train to New York and the Great White Way, never looking back. He never mentioned any Broadway shows he had ever appeared in, only a gritty, bare-bones production of a decades-old play called Fortune and Men's Eyes, in which he played a persecuted juvenile delinquent under the thumb of a sexually aggressive fellow inmate. Poppy knew how to translate his words. Gritty and bare-bones meant that the play was put on in a Lower East Side garage, that it had very few props, that nobody got paid, and that they were lucky if half of the 20 hardback chairs lined up in front of the stage were filled every night. If Poppy was good at one thing, it was interpreting actor speak. By the time they ordered their food, Matt had covered his starving actor years in New York, his therapeutic road trip out west to find himself, and his first role as surfer number 3 in an episode of NCIS Los Angeles, which secured him his SAG card. Heather was besotted, laughing too hard at his jokes, melting whenever his eyes rested on her, constantly glancing at Poppy to see if she was as charmed by this delectable vision as she was. Poppy, ever the actress herself, managed to deliver a believable, understated performance as a woman marginally interested in what this self-absorbed idiot had to say. For the sake of her daughter's feelings, she was not going to put a damper on this impromptu "Mom, meet the man of my dreams" dinner.
"The second Heather told me you were once an actress, I looked you up on IMDb. You had quite a career way back when," Matt said.
Way back when? His stock was plunging further and faster.
"I think I remember my parents watching that detective show you were in when I was little. My mom had a huge crush on the star.
Rod Harper."
"Yeah, whatever happened to him? He's still alive?"
"I believe so, yes. He's only 65. Matt chuckled.
"That's funny."
"What?"
"Only 65.
He didn't linger on the moment, completely unaware he had just insulted her. Instead, he bravely plowed ahead, oblivious to how close he was to having a margarita thrown in his face.
"And I actually remember seeing you in that Disney movie about the talking car, Speedy Goes to Le Mans, and you played the pretty French girl in the pit crew, Genevieve."
"Yes, you have a good memory," Poppy sighed.
"Well, not really. I watched it on Netflix the other night after Heather and I planned this dinner. I wanted to study up on you."
Poppy looked at her daughter again with pleading eyes that could not be sending a more clear and unequivocal message. "You can't be serious." When Matt began to roll out the idea for his one-man show, Poppy begged the waiter to hurry back with another round of drinks. At least she was feeling a comfortable buzz to help dull the pain of dining with this moron who was sucking up all the oxygen in the room. Thank heavens for the Uber app, which she could use to get home safely. She started to mentally go through her to-do list for tomorrow as he prattled on and on until the bill mercifully arrived. She waited a few minutes for Matt to at least pick up the check in order to impress his possible future mother-in-law, but no such moment came. She had finally picked it up to check the damage and to suggest they split the tab when she heard Matt say with all sincerity, "Thank you, Poppy. That's very generous of you." She bit her lip hard and told herself he was a struggling actor, probably a few months behind on his rent. She handed her American Express card to the waiter and silently prayed there was enough credit left on there to pay for the meal. Was Heather really falling for this sketchy character? She liked to think her daughter had better taste. Then again, when Poppy was 30, she was not exactly making exemplary choices when it came to men. In fact, upon reflection, she realized she had dated a few Matt Camerons herself. Actually, when she really thought about it, given her current situation, marrying Chester was probably also a disastrous choice. Maybe she had cursed her own daughter by passing along some kind of terrible taste in men gene. Thankfully, the waiter returned with two slips of paper and a pen, which meant the card had mercifully gone through. As Poppy calculated the tip and signed the receipt, Matt leapt from his chair and raced over to the mariachi band, nearly knocked the young lead singer into a potted plant as he wrestled some maracas out of the surprised man's hands and began belting out "Volver, Volver." The good news was Matt had a nice singing voice. The bad news was Matt was singing in front of the entire restaurant, much to the consternation of the mariachi singer with the pencil-thin mustache who was glaring at him after having been so rudely shoved out of the spotlight. Matt was in his element. When he finished, the entire restaurant burst into applause, and feigning modesty, Matt bashfully waved them off as he marched back over to the table, reached down, and planted another big wet kiss on his new gal's mouth. He was about to do the same to Poppy, but she quickly stood up and brushed past him for the door, passing the mariachi singer who could tell she liked Matt even less than he did. They shared a look, both silently agreeing that the mad attention whore was utterly distasteful and downright irritating. Now if she could only get her daughter to see past her new beau's insincere charm. But that was a future battle. The more pressing issue was breaking the news that Heather was no longer an heiress, thanks to Chester. But on the bright side, the fact that Heather was suddenly penniless just might do the trick in scaring off this D-list Ryan Gosling wannabe. Chapter 5. When Poppy arrived back home, her head was pounding. Not from too many margaritas, mind you, but from having to endure an achingly long meal with Heather's obnoxious new boy toy. She couldn't help but hope that the fire in her daughter's latest relationship would quickly burn out and the whole sickening romance between the two of them would soon become just a painfully bad memory. However, she also wanted Heather to be happy, and if this egotistical man-child was somehow inexplicably making her smile and feel all warm inside, then who was she to object? It was not as if Poppy herself had to spend any more time with him, or at least she hoped that would be the case. If, God forbid, Heather were to marry the guy, then there would be holidays and birthdays and Sunday family dinners to contend with, and she just couldn't bring herself to picture that awful reality just yet. Poppy undressed, slipped into a baby blue silk nightgown and matching furry slippers, and then padded to the kitchen to pour herself a nightcap. As she sat down and gulped down her drink, enjoying the little kick before bedtime, she made the decision to call Heather first thing in the morning and plan to meet for coffee, this time just the two of them. Poppy worried if she waited much longer to break the news, Heather was going to find out some other way, and she didn't want her blaming her for keeping her in the dark for so long. This situation had to be dealt with swiftly and carefully. She had recorded 60 minutes while she was out dining with Heather and Matt and was looking forward to settling into her recliner and watching that adorable Anderson Cooper report on a story about smartphone addiction when her doorbell rang. She checked the Swiss clock she had picked up on a trip to Zurich a few years ago on the wall. It was almost 9:30. Who would be dropping by at this hour? For a moment, her stomach lurched as she feared it might be Heather and Matt with a carton of ice cream to share, since Poppy had rushed out of Las Casuelas before they had a chance to order dessert. But she was enormously relieved when she opened the door to find Iris and Violet. Violet carried a covered casserole dish wrapped in tin foil in her hands. Iris had her checkbook. "What is this?"
"Chicken and biscuit casserole, my mother's recipe," Violet said, handing the dish to Poppy.
"I just ate, but thank you. I'll have some for lunch tomorrow." "So you came all the way over here to bring me a casserole?"
"Yes," Violet said, twitching and nervous.
Iris sighed.
"You're a terrible liar, Violet."
"I know," Violet wailed. "I get so nervous."
"The casserole was just an excuse. We figured if we told you the real reason we're here, you wouldn't let us in," Iris said.
"Now I'm intrigued," Poppy said. "Come on in." Iris and Violet didn't need further prodding. They marched inside and made a beeline for the kitchen, where Iris helped herself to a shot of cognac and Violet poured herself a glass of lemonade from a pitcher in the refrigerator, being the teetotaler that she was. Or at least that was what she told people, but usually only before happy hour.
"Are you hungry? I have a chicken and biscuit casserole I can serve you," Poppy playfully offered, holding out the covered dish.
"No, that's for you. Now, let's get down to business," Iris barked, sitting on a high stool next to the island in Poppy's kitchen.
"And what business is that?"
"Iris, I thought we were going to ease into it," Violet stammered.
"Why? There's no time. She's broke. She's got bills to pay," Iris argued.
"You do realize I'm here in the room with you, right?" Poppy asked. Iris nodded and then opened her checkbook and began scribbling.
"Will 8,000 be enough to get you through the next few months?"
"I beg your pardon?" Poppy gasped.
"Violet and I have pooled our resources and we're going to float you alone to get you through this rough patch."
"You're going to give me 8 grand? Poppy asked, incredulous.
"I knew we should have offered 10, Violet whispered quietly.
"No, I can't take your money," Poppy exclaimed.
"Why not?" Iris growled, personally affronted. "It's not like we stole it."
"I just don't want to accept any handouts. I'll figure this out on my own," Poppy said, touched that her two best friends were prepared to be so generous.
"This is not the time to be proud, Poppy. We're your friends and we want to help, so stop fighting us on this.
Iris said as she finished signing the check and tore it off the pad with a flourish. She handed it to Poppy, who immediately handed it back to her.
I'm sorry, I can't, Poppy said.
Then what will you do?
Look, this is all just starting to sink in. I need to meet with the lawyer again, talk to some debt consolidation advisors, and then go from there. And I appreciate your sweet offer of allowing me to stay with one of you, but I don't want to be a burden.
Violet gasped.
That could take weeks. How are you going to feed yourself in the meantime? And what happens when the house sells? Where will you go if you don't stay with one of us?
I can always stay with Heather while I look for a more permanent situation, Poppy said. Iris and Violet exchanged dubious looks and then burst into uncontrollable laughter.
That is the dumbest idea I have ever heard, Iris said. You two will be at each other's throats before you even have a chance to unpack your bag.
I think I'm capable of living with my daughter for a couple of weeks while I look for a place, Poppy said, trying to convince herself. Iris was having none of it. She stared down Poppy, whose confident exterior began to crack almost instantly. She knew Iris was right.
Maybe I'll be lucky and find a place really fast, like in a week or so. You know, on second thought, I bet Heather will love having you stay at her place. I get the feeling she's been lonely lately, and the company would surely do her good, Violet said, always in search of a positive note.
That's not a problem anymore. She has a new boyfriend, Poppy sighed, not even making an effort to hide her scorn.
Uh-oh, so you've met him?
Iris asked. Yes, tonight, but I'd rather not talk about it, Poppy said.
That bad, huh?
Iris shook her head sympathetically. Violet snatched the check out of Iris's hand and tried shoving it toward Poppy again, who adamantly waved it away.
I appreciate the thought, but you girls need that money, and I wouldn't feel right taking it.
Stop worrying about me. I can find a way to buy my groceries.
How?
Iris asked, challenging her.
I'll think of something, Poppy said, knowing her worry lines were probably showing on her forehead.
What about a babysitter? Violet piped in excitedly.
I haven't done that since I was 16 years old, Poppy said.
Not a babysitter, really, a companion. I've seen a lot of postings at the senior center where I take my self-defense class looking for a part-time paid companion for wealthy elderly people who need to be looked after during the day until a family member can come home and take over at night after work.
What would I have to do? Poppy asked.
Prepare lunch, take him or her for a ride in the car, play Scrabble once in a while, maybe light water aerobics in the pool once a week. It sounds like the easiest job in the world, Violet said.
I could do that, Poppy agreed.
Finally, some hope. Perhaps she had found a temporary solution to keep the lights on in her home that was about to be sold by the bank for a fraction of its value. Looking after an 80-year-old a few times a week. Seriously, how hard could that be?
Chapter 6.
What do you mean you can't find her?
Clifford Wentworth screamed over the phone at Poppy. Poppy stood outside the elegant multi-million-dollar home nestled against the mountain in the Tony area of Las Palmas, just west of downtown Palm Springs. Her cell phone was clamped to her ear.
I was in the kitchen, making her a sandwich for lunch, and she gave me the slip, Poppy said, out of breath, having frantically searched inside and outside the expansive property. I caught a glimpse of her running past the window outside, near the pool, and came out to catch her, but now she's gone again.
You were tasked with keeping an eye on my mother for 3 days a week, not with playing hide-and-seek with her,
Clifford huffed angrily.
I know, Mr. Wentworth, but she's very difficult to corral.
Poppy was just being polite. Estelle Wentworth, the 89-year-old matriarch of a wealthy family who had made their fortune selling sandwich condiments, was a living, breathing nightmare to behold. Poppy had actually been afraid she might be bored when she accepted the position as a companion to the spry octogenarian 3 days a week while her son and his wife flew back east to take care of the family business in Pittsburgh. But Estelle had turned out to be much more than just a handful. She was demanding, paranoid, and perhaps...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.